Good evening, my dear young friends. Some of them joined us just now. Sisters and brothers, it's a real privilege to be here with the Asia Society and all of you. We live in the world of globalization, and this is not a budge word. We have been hearing, we have been talking, we have been giving speeches and listening and framing our policies around the globalization. Globalization of economy, markets, production, knowledge, technology, and so on. And we have all seen the good results as well as the flip side of it. But before coming to this topic, let me share you a short story. Wherever I go, people think Nobel laureates are very special, outstanding, exclusive, celebrities, etc. Yesterday, I was addressing the Allahabad University's convocation. And today there were other things. So there was a journalist driving in countryside, and he noticed that a man was standing in an open field under the sun and looking at the sky, doing nothing. So he slowed down his car, stopped, and went close to this guy and asked, "Sir, what are you doing here?" He answered, don't waste my time. Don't disturb me. I am busy with something very special." This made journalist more curious, obviously. So he, after 10 minutes, he asked, "Sir, may I ask now, what are you doing here under the open sun?" He said, "If you're asking, let me tell you that what I learned in my childhood, that those who are outstanding in their fields, they become the Nobel laureates. I'm waiting for the Nobel Prize." And look at me, I'm out and standing in my own field. So one day I will become the Nobel laureate. So nothing is special about us. When I started my journey, I tried to ask myself, what was my driver? What has driven me? I've read about Gandhi and I tried to analyze Gandhiji's life and work. And the most impressive thing I found in him was that he was one of those rarest leaders in the world who were able to convert the great human values, universal values, or spiritual values into a social movement and then in a political movement. The people used to teach peace in the temples and mosques and churches, holy places. The holy men used to talk about ahimsa, non-violence. But there was no example where the non-violence, peace, and truth have been transformed into the social movement, such mass mobilization and the fight for freedom, independence. So we are inspired by people like that. And then when I started working against child slavery and child labor, nobody was working on it in India or anywhere in the world. People thought that slavery has been abolished about 100 years ago after the proclamation against slavery signed and executed in the United States and some international laws were in place. So human slavery was not a major issue, or at least child slavery was not talked about. United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child was adopted only in 1989. And before that, there was no proper articulation of the rights of children, where the children are considered important and protected with the fullest cover of human rights. So it was very tough to work. But the very first day of my schooling was the first spark in my life when I saw, I was five and a half years old, and saw a boy my age sitting outside the school gate. He was a cobbler. So when I was entering in my school, in my small hometown, Vidisha, I was born and grew up in a modest family, I noticed that the boy was looking at our feet, not towards us, means the children who were going to school. That made me a little bit upset, disappointed. I asked a question to my teacher, perhaps the first question I have ever asked to any authority outside my mother and father's family. Sir, why this boy is sitting outside the school gate and not with the rest of us in the classroom? He said, calm down, this is not uncommon. Poor children have to help the families. I said, okay, sir. But when I was coming back, I saw the boy still working there. And the next day, I asked my mother, my friends, my relatives, that why a child is not with the rest of us in the classroom? Everybody has similar answers. Poverty, poor children have to help the families. But that made me more angry inside. Because I was not convinced with those questions, those answers. And I could feel that the answers are ready-made. Everybody is giving the same answers, means these answers were made 100 years ago. That is the mental complacency in a way. So one day I gathered my courage and went straight to the boy and also his father, who was sitting alongside, polishing shoes. The boy was shy. But father replied with folded hands. You know, the Indian caste system 50 years ago, 60 years ago, it was even more intense and more cruel in a way. So with folded hands, he answered, Babuji, maine to kabhi socha nahi. I never thought about it, he said. And my father, grandfather, and he started working since they were children. And so is my son, he said. And then he suddenly stood up with, again, folded hands, took a pause. I could feel his misery. I could feel his helplessness, He said, Babuji, school jane ke liye to aap log paida hote hain. Hum log to isi kaam ke liye paida hue hain. We are born to work, he said. I could not understand. I started crying out of pain, out of anger. I could not do anything for that boy. But now, just after the announcement of my Nobel Prize, people started questioning the journalists from all across the world. That what was your spark? Why did you think like that? Why did you start working on this issue, which was a non-issue those days? I started digging inside me in finding the answer. And then I realized that if I have to say it in one word, that is compassion. And that compassion led me to take big decisions. My parents wanted to make me engineer. My father was a policeman. He passed away when I was young. My mother had to sell her ornaments for my higher studies. After my graduation, I did my specialization in high voltage transformer design and started teaching in the university. But I felt that I was not doing justice to myself, to my heart. And I decided to give up that job. Perhaps my wife, Sumedha Ji, who is sitting here, was the only person who was convinced that though nobody was working on this issue, but we can challenge and change this menace. There were lots and lots of charity organizations. There were a lot of individuals who were doing charity to the children. But I never convinced with that. I was thinking that if I help 10 children or 20 or 200 or 200,000, this is not going to solve the purpose. Unless we turn off the tap, the water will keep on flowing. So where is the place? There were systematic designs and modules of exploitation. The systemic root causes, and so on. The policy deficits, social, cultural deficits, knowledge deficit. So I decided to give up my job and started writing in the newspapers and magazines about this issue. But one day they were also exhausted. They said that how long we can keep on writing about the issues of children in slavery, and it has not yet been established because India did not have any law against child labor. So I started my own magazine. And one day, a desperate father whose daughter was about to be sold to a brothel knocked my door. His name was Vasal Khan, and Vasal narrated me. He came only with one single hope and expectation that I am going to write his story. Perhaps the authorities can read it and help. So I was shocked when he said that 17 years ago, he and his newly married wife were taken away, lured away from his native village in Chandigarh to work at a brick kiln in Punjab. During those 17 years, they were not allowed to leave. All children were born and grew up there. No wages, no medical care, including 15-year-old Sabo. And when the parents saw that some brothel agents came to negotiate the price of that girl, touching her body in different places. The landlord was demanding more money, slave master, which the brothel people were not willing to pay. The deal was not materialized. So what a father will do? Many of us sitting here are fathers of our children, brothers, sisters, mothers. At least all of us were children one day, someday. So he jumped into a brick-loaded truck without knowing where the truck was going to, and somehow reached Chandigarh, and with the help of someone reached to me. I tell you, my sisters, my brothers, when I was writing this story, I started feeling that if she was my sister, I was 26, if she was my sister or my daughter, what would I do? I'm not going to simply write and wait for some action to be taken. I would have held the whole world upside down to rescue my daughter to my sister. Then I brought him to my home. My home was 8 feet by 10 foot room, where we lived for about 5 years. My wife, me, and my one-year-old son, Vasal, stayed there. I requested Sumedha ji to give her wedding ornaments so that we can organize some logistics and take the risk. Vasal was pleading, saying that, please don't go with, leave me on my fate, because these people will kill you and me. They are mafia, they have guns. But when we reached there, somehow, we were all beaten up. Four of my friends and I. Vasal was caught. I had to come empty hands, but not empty heart. I always believed that whenever a problem is born, the solution is also born inside the womb of the problem. We should have patience, we should have courage, we should have conviction. We should believe in ourselves. Those who believe in God, they should believe in God. But first of all, we should believe in ourselves that we can solve the problem. I came back, empty hands, as I said, barefooted, torn clothes. Then an idea came to my mind to go to judiciary. Met a friend of mine who was a lawyer. He helped in taking this case under the habeas corpus petition in the High Court of Delhi. That was in March 1981. And within few days, we were able to free not only this beautiful 15-year-old sister of mine, Sabo, but 36 children, women and men. This is the first documented freedom operation, not the national independence, freeing children from slavery through some citizens' effort, private effort. But that was the moment of truth for me, when I saw that children were jumping on the streets. Those who are familiar with Delhi, so High Court is very close to India Gate. And my office was close to Mandi House in a small balcony of a friend of mine. So all these children were jumping on the streets, cars were honking, and the children never saw those cars. They have never seen those buildings. It was beyond their comprehension, beyond their imagination. So it was like you put a lot of frogs in a basket and suddenly you open the cover and they jump. And I was holding hands of all these beautiful children who were born and grew up in slavery. I could see the purest smile of childhood freedom on the faces of those children. The mothers were crying in tears. Tears were rolling down on their cheeks. I tell you, this was the first time I have seen, I have felt the glimpse of God's on the faces of the smiling faces of those children. I could feel, I could see the God for the first time in the tears of joy on the faces of those mothers. I never looked back since then. What else you want? You can talk about God, divinity, godliness, purity, humanity, all these things. And if you keep on talking, using these words, heavy words, they gradually become hollow. they lose their power. Sometimes I feel that God has lost his power because we are using it for our commercial purpose. We are using for everything, for excuses. We are making sins, and in the name of God, we wanted to hide behind those, the God. Feel God inside. That was my first lesson. And then, now the world asked me, Kailash ji, what was that? Why did you think of it? Why did you take this kind of risky, you know, this risk? And I was trying to analyze, I was trying to find answers, and this comes in one word, and that is compassion. Normally, we are covered with so many layers when we, as a human being, when we connect with others and other issues and other sufferings, we connect with very superficial or outer circle of sympathy. We are sympathetic to someone if somebody is having some problem. That is good as a human trait. But that is not enough. That is spontaneous, it can go away. Then little bit inner circle is empathy. Empathy is a feeling, a deeper feeling of suffering of others as it is your own suffering. So that is even better when you start feeling like that. But most people stop there. And when you are empathetic, it's a good human character. But if you're not able to change that situation of suffering, you become exhausted, burnout, anxiety, nervousness, depression, failure, these things come. So what you call the empathy exhaust. But the most important thing which we lose the sight of is compassion. Compassion is the feeling for suffering of others as it is my own suffering. Suffering of any unknown person as my own suffering, with a strong desire and drive to take action to get rid of that suffering. That is compassion. So these are three different things: sympathy, empathy, and compassion. When you have deep desire, that means you have to take initiative. You have to use your inner power and energy. You have to be strategic as a problem solver. You're not depressed. You don't sit as a failed person. You start thinking new ideas, how to solve that problem of suffering of others, feeling, thinking that it is your own suffering. All the religions in the world, all the religions I underline, have one single spark, one single root. They are born out of compassion. Jesus, Muhammad, Lord Krishna, Lord Rama, Guru Nanak Dev Ji, Buddha, Mahavir, you name anyone. And if you read their life, I know most of you know about it. But how would you explain when they felt the suffering of others, the injustices around them, the wrongs around them, and became the savior, started to solve the problem of others? They did not sit quiet in their homes. They did not remain confined among themselves. But very interesting part is that all the revolutions, all the social transformations also begin with compassion. Why Mars stood up against injustices and inequalities, exploitation? Why Lenin did it? Why Mao did it? Why Che Guevara did it? One may or may not agree with their ideologies, with their, you know, approaches, but one cannot ignore that all the religions and all the revolutions have just one single spark, and that is compassion. When I say that we live in a globalized world, it's a paradox. When we look at Brexit, I work across 144 to be precise, countries, for last 20, 25 years, not now. And I have seen that how this politics, economy, society is changing. A lot of good things are happening, undoubtedly, undoubtedly. But the politics of xenophobia, politics of Islamophobia, politics of populism, all these things have grown across the world. We have also seen that how we have expanded ourselves, globalized ourselves in economies and production. We cannot live without speed and digit. As we used to talk about time and space, we are somewhere fixed between time and space. Today we are fixed somewhere between speed and digit. We cannot live without high-speed internet. I was really quite angry with my friends when my phone was not working, though it is one of the latest phones, iPhone 10 Plus. And I'm still waiting for next week that iPhone 11 is coming. Perhaps it may have better speed, 4G speed, and so on. So we cannot live without the high-speed internet, high-speed chats. Yesterday, we used a smaller plane from Allahabad to Delhi, and it took us about 2 hours. And we flew this morning, and it took less than 2 hours, or almost 2 hours. Allahabad is so close to Delhi in comparison to Mumbai. So these things come to our mind. But I ask a simple question. Are we really, genuinely, honestly connected with each other as human beings? Our connection of trust, our relationship of trust, even with our own spouses, our own sisters and brothers, our respect, our love, without expectation, has shrunk. That is reflecting in creating walls and demanding walls between the countries. What we saw in America, what we are seeing in Brazil, what we are seeing in many of the Latin American countries, what we have seen in Europe. This is not a politics which is going to unite the world as a global village, as a global world. We all realize that the soul of globalization is shrinking. The soul of globalization is in danger. It's not economy, it's not knowledge, it's humanity that has to come closer. Protect each other, be the savior of each other. That is unfortunately not happening. So in this age of globalization, we have to rethink. The West has given us the models of globalization, the philosophy of globalization. But that is the materialistic mindset, consumeristic mindset, market mindset, profit mindset. Thousands of years ago, Indian rishi says, "Ayam nijah paroveti ganana laghu chetasham udara charitarnam tu vasudhaiva kutumbukam." This is yours and that is mine. Is the calculation of mean mentality. The people who are liberal, for them, the whole world is one family. Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Thousands of years ago, the Rigveda, Rishi of Rigveda says, Sangachadhum samvadadhum samvo manansi janatam deva bhagam yatha purve sanjananam upasate. Let us walk together. We have to create a level playing field where we can walk together. Nobody is left out. Nobody is left behind. We have to create an environment where we can express ourselves freely. We can talk freely. Samvadadhum. We all can talk to each other with free minds, with open hearts, without any fear. That is Sangvadadhum. Thousands of years ago, the Vedic Rishi says. And it goes up to saying that let us create a knowledge. And that is knowledge for all. Sanjananam upasate. Let us come together and know the world, the society, the humanity, which can benefit everyone. That is the soul. That is the globalization. So today, in this age of globalization of knowledge and economies and markets, India is the land that should rise. Indians should give a clarion call to the world that let us globalize compassion. Let us globalize compassion. You can do it. I know that many of you who are sitting here, I know a few of you, but I know that you are people who have some influence, some power, more resources than a person like me or many people like me. You can do it. We can do it. When I started working in Pakistan in the 80s, when I first visited Pakistan and saw the children working in brick kiln factories and enslaved, nobody was talking about it. But I could not hold myself. I said to the Pakistani friends that, look, we have to launch a campaign here I did it in India in 80, 81. They said, no, you are an Indian, you are a Hindu, how could you do it? I said, no, I wanted to be with those people and I wanted to launch a campaign. And I had a large meeting with thousands of workers, their children, women. And it was reported in some of the Pakistani newspapers. It was reported in the papers and Kailash Satyarthi was deported to India. But that was the beginning of a movement against child slavery in Pakistan as well. So Pakistanis blamed that Kailash Satyarthi is a raw agent. And since I started loving and working for my children in Pakistan, the Indians said that he is an ISI agent. So I've heard before that there are double agents. There are some Hollywood movies also about the KGB and CIA agents, but I laughed at it, but I enjoyed too. So my first major effort of applied compassion or compassion and action to mobilize and globalize the world was the Global March Against Child Labor. In 1998, actually, the idea came to me in 1996. I spoke to some of my friends that let us fight for an international law to stop child slavery, child prostitution. Some of my friends Kailash ji, you go and contest the municipal corporation election and come back, and then if you win, then we will think that you should contest for MP election or MLA election. I said, I don't think that it is necessary to be the MP or MLA to change the world. No MLA or MP or Prime Minister or Minister has ever changed the world. They think that they are changing the world. Not bad. But I said that ordinary people change the world. Ordinary people. Common people. Unknown people. Unnoticed people. Unrecognized people. So I said that let us march across the globe. Children should lead the march. Children who were enslaved, sold and bought like animals and sometimes in lesser price than the animals. They should lead the march. Former child soldiers should lead the march and I will help them in facilitating. In 1998, we organized 80,000 kilometers march. You know how big is the periphery of the earth? Can somebody tell? Yeah, so about 40,000. So we covered 80,000, almost double than the periphery of the earth. We covered 103 countries. And to the surprise of many people, 71 presidents, prime ministers, kings and queens joined the march physically. Because the march was led by children themselves. The three marches, one from Manila, one from Sao Paulo, and one from Cape Town. It took about 6 months. And when we reached in Geneva in the General Assembly of International Labour Organization with this demand that we need an international law, I was standing on the dais and I challenged the world leaders who were sitting there that I don't think that the world is so poor that cannot take away the tools and guns from the tiny hands. World has enough resources to replace those tools and guns with toys and books and pencils. Children themselves spoke and said that no more tools in tiny hands, we want books, we want toys. And the powerful moral voices of the children could not remain ignored, unheard. The presidents and prime ministers were in tears when they talked to those children. And within a week, a resolution has been taken by the international community that next year, by next year, we will draft such an international law and we will adopt it. And in 1999, the ILO convention, which was just referred, has been unanimously adopted by the General Assembly. And since then, the number of child laborers have gone down from 260 million to 150 million. More than 100 million children's lives were saved. But that means we were able to create at least 100 to 150 million new jobs. Why? How? Every single child laborer is working at the cost of one adult's job. Today we have 150 million children in full-time jobs and 210 million adults jobless. And there are many studies which prove that in the countries where the parents are not given assured jobs for more than 100 days a year, their children are bound to go to work as child laborers. So that makes a vicious circle of unemployment, adult unemployment, and child labor, or the poverty and child labor. So child labor perpetuates poverty. Child labor perpetuates unemployment. Child labor perpetuates illiteracy. We live in a world where we cannot think of social justice, economic justice, we cannot think of economic growth, sustained economic growth in the country, we cannot think of justice, gender justice, without an education and good quality education. And we all know that education is key to all kind of miseries and injustices prevail in our society. Child labor is the biggest problem. I'm going to sum up here, and then we have question answers with Brian. But then we realize that we have to have another massive campaign for education. So enthusiast and excited with the success of the campaign, the Global March Against Child Labor, me and my colleagues globally have launched another massive campaign, global campaign for education. Our demand was that education should not be considered charity or just one of those 100 or 200 development agenda items, but education should be considered as fundamental human right. Every child is born free. Freedom and learning are the birthrights. If a child is born free, she has all the rights to cry, learn, demand. That is the natural right. That is the divine right. That cannot be jeopardized. So we launched this campaign in 2000. I was the chair of both these campaigns for decades, but I gave up after the Nobel Prize or before that. That time, the number of out-of-school children in primary classes was 130 million. Those were out of school, primary school age going, I mean. That number has gone down to less than 60 million in 15 years. Less than half. So, one thing is clear, that the problems which our children are facing are solvable. These goals are achievable, affordable, possible. We have to have that strong conviction. Dear friends, you see the problems of children around you. In this hour, when I'm standing with you, 8 children will go missing. Their mothers are not going to cook food for a day or two or days together. Years together, they cannot eat properly. They will not celebrate any Eid, any Diwali, any Christmas. The last 1 hour is the saga of their missing children, 8 children. Now, during this hour, at least 4 children might have been raped somewhere or sexually abused in my country. When the girls say, I was sold for 10,000 rupees, and in my village, a buffalo cost 200,000 rupees. Mere gaon mein main 10,000 rupaye mein biki jab Assam ki ladki kehti hai, aur mere gaon mein bhains 2 lakh rupaye mein bikti hai, to mere dil mein hazaron sawal khade hote hain. Main aisi betiyon se milta hoon, I meet with those daughters, 12, 13, 14 years old daughters, who have been raped by their teachers, and they don't want to go to school, they don't want to talk of education. I met a girl, 15-year-old, who was crying outside a police station in Delhi. She said, I feel very guilty. I asked my daughter, why are you feeling guilty? Why are you crying? She said, I made a big sin today because I have made a complaint against my father. The girl says, I was very tired for a few days and having fever. I told my father last night, please leave me tonight. Don't pull me in bed. I will do whatever you like tomorrow, but today at least, spare me. He didn't. In the morning, I had to come to hospital and then to police station. They sent me to police station, bleeding badly. The girl was not bleeding. India was bleeding. If one single daughter of this country is in danger, then India is not safe. If one single daughter or son is sold and bought like animals in lesser price than the animals, India cannot be proud of anything. I am angry. Everybody has to be angry. If my sons and daughters are raped and sold and enslaved, if they remain voiceless, nameless, faceless, what is the bright face we wanted to show to the world? We cannot simply blame on the government. We cannot simply blame on the corporate. We cannot simply blame on others. This is me to be blamed. Everybody should feel that I am not doing my bit. Perhaps I am not doing my bit. India is the land of Durga, the goddess of power. India is the land of Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth. Saraswati is the goddess of wisdom and knowledge. What is happening with our daughters, with our sisters, with our mothers, with our wives? We have to change it. We have the power to change it. In all those years in the history, we have moved. We have achieved a lot. The last bit needs you, my dear friends. Being intellectual is good. Talking about good things is good. But ignite compassion. Don't confine your compassion to your own siblings, your own biological children. Don't confine your compassion to your spouses and your brothers and sisters, your mothers and fathers and couple of friends. You have enough compassion inside you. God can never be so meager that he is giving you or she is giving you a bit of compassion to live with, a drop of compassion. No. God has given us an ocean of compassion. I don't feel that my arms are so small that I can only hug my daughter or my son or my wife. I feel my arms are large enough to hug the whole world, to embrace the whole world inside them. You should have that feeling. We are the children of divinity. We are the children of divinity. No one else can make India a great India again. Nobody can make the world a safe, sustainable, peaceful world. It is you. It's you. It's you. It's all of us. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Asia Society, for giving me this opportunity, this honor and privilege. In my profession, we get to meet a lot of billionaires. Okay. So I was saying, in our profession, we get to meet a lot of billionaires. We get to meet top politicians. We meet outstanding sportspersons and celebrity film stars. But we never get to meet people who are changing the world, right? So this is indeed an honor and privilege, right? So Mr. Satyarthi, thank you very much. I'd like to begin by asking you a question on, you said that you feel like just like anybody else being a Nobel laureate. But from terms of your work, how has the Nobel been a kind of enabler, force multiplier on the global stage?
Double check that whether I was an electrical engineer or not. Anyway, frankly speaking, When the Nobel Peace Prize was announced, it was a huge surprise for me. I could never imagine that the prize, which has never been given to any natural Indian-born citizen, the Peace Prize, has suddenly conferred to someone who was largely unknown or silently working in my own way. So it was a big surprise. And then I started feeling that, thanks to the Nobel Committee, that first time in their history of 100 years or more than 100 years of Nobel Peace Prizes, they have chosen the issue of the last person of human society, and that is the child who is enslaved. That is the child who is tortured, abused, exploited, a girl in Africa, in Latin America, in Asia. So I was thankful to them that first time this Peace Prize is being given to this cause through a humble and simple Indian. So I was thankful to them. Then I thought that, then within no time actually, Brian, I realized that it is such a big thing. I didn't know the power of that, because in front of my office and house, hundreds of international media and hundreds of national media people were lining up for interviews, and every single newspaper or news channel were calling from all across the world. And one of the good things was that most of them never heard Kailash Satyarthi. Who is Kailash Satyarthi? So they were more curious about me. So that was good. But immediately I had a resolve that this is just a comma in my life. This can never be the full stop. The full stop will come when we end this menace of child slavery from the earth. So I know my life, I know my purpose, I know my dream and my mission. So I said that, I started thinking that I don't want to use this opportunity. So when the Secretary General those days, Ban Ki-moon. So Ban Ki-moon called me up, and then President Obama and so many presidents and prime ministers and other people in the world, they started calling, and I said immediately, thank you, sir, but I wanted to meet and talk to you, madam. I wanted to meet you. So they said, sure, Kailash. So, sure. So we didn't know what does it mean. As they call the Nobel Prize, it is basically the Nobel Prize. So you need not to ring the bell, you can enter. So I started entering. So I had to wait to meet a parliament member in India for months together to talk about the issue of child slavery, and then I started meeting President Obama and others. So I told, when President Obama was in India, my wife and I met him and his wife. Actually, there are not too many Nobel Peace Laureates living in the world, only 20 or so. So whenever we go to each other's country, we try to meet courteously. So the White House called us, so we met. So I said, President Obama, I had an agenda that United Nations is going to adopt the new development agenda. This is Sustainable Development Goal, SDGs. In MDGs, I did every possible thing. I even went on holding a demonstration in front of the UN in year 2000 when the Millennium Development Goals were adopted, that eradication of child labor, slavery, trafficking of children, forced labor should be incorporated in MDGs, but it was not possible. Now in SDGs, this is my demand that these things should be incorporated. So I spoke to President Hollande, Prime Ministers of Norway, Sweden, and so many people, President of World Bank, President of IMF, all people. You name, I met them, spoke to them. And nobody could say no to a Nobel laureate. Then I realized, oh, what does it mean? But for me, this Nobel Peace Prize was not in my mind. The reason was that when the prize was announced, I met the President of India, of course, the Prime Minister also. So Pranav Da was very, very moved, and he said that, Kailash, perhaps you don't know that India, the land of 1.2, 1.3 billion people, don't have any Nobel medal. I was surprised. He said that the first Nobel medal came to India through Rabindranath Tagore ji, and that medal was stolen. And he said that when he was the foreign minister, he went all the way to take a replica from Sweden. But then he was more moved and emotional that this is the Peace Prize, the supreme of all. So you are bringing that prize to our country. So Sumedha, my wife, and I started thinking, my daughter, Asmita, who is sitting here, and my son, who is in Delhi. So we thought that why this medal belonged to us? We should give it away to the nation. So I wrote a letter to the President of India that, Mr. President, I had an idea. That since India does not have any Nobel Peace Medal or any Nobel medal, the real gold one, not the replica, then I wanted to give it away to the nation through you. Please accept it. So he called me up and he said, Are you okay, Kailash ji? Is it you who have written the letter? I said, yes, this is my handwritten letter. This is handwriting. And this is my handwriting. This is not email. So he said he could not say anything. Then he said that it never happened in the history of the world that any crazy Nobel Peace Laureate has offered this medal to his nation or her nation. So I finally decided, I said that I am going to leave it to Rajghat, Mahatma Gandhi's memorial, if he is not going to take it up. Then he has to change a protocol, he has to create a new protocol, and we went to him and gave that medal. He could not believe, he was looking at the medal. And I said to the nation, not to him, I said, through you I wanted to tell to every Indian that mera mujhme kachu nahi jo kachu hai sab tor aur tera tujhko saunpte kya lagat hai mor. So maine de diya usko, I have given it to her. But then I kept on working for this new sustainable development goal. And I was very happy to tell you, this is not just because of me, there are so many individuals, so many organizations must be working behind the curtail. But finally, in the sustainable development goal 8.7 on the eradication of child labor in a time-bound manner, total eradication of slavery, trafficking, child prostitution, forced labor has been incorporated. Now it is the part of global policy agenda. It is the part of global program that has been the biggest success after the Nobel Peace Prize. I didn't want to miss that opportunity. But the recent one was that when we realized that child sexual abuse has grown as a kind of moral epidemic. We don't have enough courts, we don't have enough accountability mechanism, the government does not put adequate resources and so on, the people are not aware. So we decided to organize a march from Kanyakumari to Kashmir to Delhi in 6 phases, a long march which covered 12,000 kilometers distance in year 2017, and almost 12 million people physically participated in the march with this demand, Surakshit Bachpan, Surakshit Bharat. So my fellow Nobel laureate friends called me up. Kailash, I saw your photo that you are marching in the villages. What are you doing? You are a celebrity now. Why don't you talk to your prime minister and president? I said, I am talking to them, but I always believe in the power of ordinary people who live in India's villages. And I said that I am not a celebrity. I am an activist in heart. I am one of those common Indians in heart. And I am going to change this menace. And I tell you that when the march ended up, culminated, President of India, the new president, has offered and hosted us in the Rashtrapati Bhavan. And within a year, all the state governments and the central government either amended the laws on rape of children or POXO, the sexual abuse, or changed the laws or made new laws. That has been the result within 1.5 years. It is possible.
Excellent.
So perhaps the power of Nobel Prize.
Sure. Okay. Let's talk about the journey that began so many decades ago. And over all these decades, you've nearly perfected this model of education, rehabilitation, and integration of these children into the mainstream society. That takes a lot of doing. So how did you really go about putting all these together?
Well, when we started freeing children, the biggest challenge was that where to take them to. So when they were only 2 or 3 or 4, Sumedha and I and my children brought them to our home, and they were living with us for a day or 2 or 1 week. Then we have to look the bigger, houses for them, and then we had to look for temples or mosques or whatever, gurudwaras. And we used to bring, Rakesh Sengar is sitting here, we used to bring rotis from gurudwaras to feed them. So all these things were happening. So finally we decided, somebody has helped us in constructing a small ashram in Delhi, that is Mukti Ashram. So my dream was that this should not be a conventional charity center. I had a dream that the children who are educated and trained here, vocational training, education, rehabilitation, reintegration, all these things, but more important thing, liberation from inside, self-confidence, self-esteem building, self-leadership building, so that they should become the leaders and liberators of themselves. And I am proud to say that thousands of such children who are no more children, of course they are adults, they are the champions and ambassadors and activists in their own way, in their own home villages. So that was the model. But we didn't have enough money to have a bigger place. So my daughter, Asmita, who is sitting here, she was 10 years old and she was invited to speak, to address the Canadian Labour Congress and the U.S. Senate. She was the youngest to address the U.S. Senate at the age of 10 on this issue of child labor and slavery. So the host and organizers said they have given her a $10,000 check and told that we will take care of all your education in the future. So she was speaking from the dais, and me and my wife were sitting in front. And then she said to the host of the Canadian Labour Congress, where about 100,000 people were attending, she said that my parents can manage my study. This money is important for us. But I wanted to do something with that money. I heard that my parents always worried about expanding this rehabilitation center. So I wanted to give this money to buy a new land and new rehabilitation center. So that child did not know that how much it cost. So these people laughed and they said that, daughter, perhaps you don't know how much money is needed. Tell your parents that you need more money. So Canadian Auto Workers Confederation decided to build the whole big rehabilitation center and pay the recurring cost for 6 years. So they paid the recurring cost of the center for 6 years. This is Balashram. So we have about 100 children staying in Balashram. About 50 or 40 stay in Delhi's Mukti Ashram. Then we have also built this Balikashram. But I am proud to say that many of these children are exemplary. Some of them became engineers. Last year, four of my children became engineers. This year, two children became engineers. One child became a lawyer. I can tell in 10 seconds that Amal Lal, who was rescued from stone quarries along with his father and brother, then he was 7 years old. He was a very bright child, wanted to become a lawyer. So he did his law course. He completed his law course last year, Balashram child. Last month or 2 months ago, he came to me and my wife and touched our feet. He was wearing this black coat and this, what you call the lawyer's advocate's tie. And he said that I appeared in my first case. And the case was, when we asked what was the case, he said that this was my first case. I saw that a man was crying because he could not find a lawyer whose daughter was raped by a police officer. So he went, under the pressure of police people, he went to withdraw the case. And he was looking for a lawyer who can help in withdrawing the case. Otherwise, they were threatening him and his daughter. So when he heard this, he went, he took this man in front of the judge, and he stood for this guy and this girl. That was his first case, Amallah's first case. Our own son, my own son, is one of the top lawyers and in the Supreme Court, and does a lot of work on policy with the government and so on. We were happy all the time, but this time, me and my wife were in tears because that is the real fruit of all our efforts. When the Amal Lal stood for a girl who was raped and nobody was standing for her. So this is the model of our rehabilitation.
Okay, it has.
Asmita is sitting here. Asmita, can you stand up for a while? I don't want to put spotlight on you, but you are there.
Yeah, so it hasn't really been easy for you. You faced criticism, you faced violence, you all have been beaten up several times. Any particular incidents or anecdotes that still stick in your mind of some really tough, sticky situations?
There were several, I tell you. I have my left foot broken, my right shoulder is broken, my backbone is broken. I have scars everywhere on my head. So that was life. But one thing I could recall, that once I went to rescue some girls who were trafficked to India from Nepal, and they were all forced to work in circus in a place called Gonda in Uttar Pradesh. And I learned that this circus owner was not only a mafia or a criminal, but he was facing some murder cases and so on. So it was a very tough operation. So we went along with those mothers of the girls, and my son, who just started practicing lawyer, and Rakesh Sanger, who is sitting here, he was there. So we went to rescue those girls. And we were taken inside, and suddenly this man took out his gun and put on my head. And this was a matter of fraction of seconds. The police officer who was standing behind, he was warning him, not because of me to save me, but he was hinting at him that look at the camera, because there was a camera running, camera of Aaj Tak TV, that has shown the whole thing live later on. So he was warning and saying that you are creating evidence. What are you doing here? Look at the camera. So the man looked at the camera and he jumped on the camera and thrown away and started beating the camera. So that was the fraction of second I was narrowly escaped. But then this man was so furious, he ordered his man to kill me and Bhuvan, my son. And so some of the mothers were badly beaten up. My son and I were lying in the pool of blood in front of the circus gate. The bypassers saw us there after a while and they took us to a hospital, and both of us were lying in the so-called casualty or emergency ward. And I looked at him and he was still alive, so I smiled. And he looked at me and I was alive. So I told that my son, nothing is lost because both of them are alive.
Right. Okay, let's talk about Goodweave, the brand you built originally, Rugmark, right, to create awareness and positive action in the carpet industry, which was a haven for child labor. Has a lot changed over the years, and has that, and maybe you could tell us how that movement has actually gone global and created awareness amongst people in the developed world who were so used to buying these carpets.
Yeah. So, Indian carpet industry those days had a stigma of having about 300,000 to 400,000, 3-4 lakh child laborers, and most of them were enslaved, bonded laborers, and trafficking victims. Pakistan had almost 500,000, and Nepal has about 2 million. So altogether, 10 million children were working in carpet industry up South Asia. That used to produce almost 3/4 quantity of the world's carpet. But most of the carpets were for export because they were very fine carpets. Few Indians can buy those most expensive carpets from Bhadohi, Banaras, Kashmir, and so on. Then we keep on freeing the children, taking risk, and on the other hand, larger number of children were entering because of the demand for cheap carpet in Europe and America. So that has prompted me to launch a campaign involving some of the exporters, some importers, manufacturers, consumers, everyone. I underline here that even the phrase corporate social responsibility was not yet coined. Nobody knows about this. Nobody was talking about it. It was the time in late 80s when we started this, that corporations should be held accountable and responsible, and so are the consumers. So the ethical consumerism or ethical production were not the phrases used. But I started thinking that all carpet manufacturers are also the mothers and fathers of someone. They do have heart, they do have soul. Let us touch their soul with pure mind. I was not a politician. I was not asking for money or anything. But I just wanted to remind them that these carpets are dirty carpets if you produced out of sweat and blood of children. That should not happen. People thought that I was doing too much. It is not possible. But I loved those people. I never hate. I could not recall whether I hated those people. I thought that they are ignorant people. Perhaps their upbringing is wrong. Something is wrong, but I cannot hate them. I'm not against them. They are not my enemy. I wanted to make them friends. And slowly, initially 2 carpet exporters manufacturers, then 8, then 30, then 300, almost all agreed with this idea. Then I went to Pakistan and started assembling Pakistanis and Nepalis. Nepal was easier, of course, easiest. And then we launched this Goodweave. Earlier it was called Rugmark. That was the first ever social labeling. After thorough monitoring and certification of the production and supply chain. So now everybody is talking of the supply chain, but those days the phrase supply chain was not yet used. But we have gone through thorough inspection mechanism and certification and then labeling. It was very, very well received by the consumers across the world, the importers and the market people. And I am proud to say that In mid-late 80s, the number of child laborers, slave child laborers in South Asian carpet industry was 1 million. 1 million, as I said. Now that has gone down to less than 200,000. So 800,000 children were saved. But that is not the case. The most important that the export, the production did not go down. It got increased because the demand increased. Europeans and Americans started demanding that good carpet or fair carpet, or what they call clean carpet. And so demand grew. So we were able to create at least 1 million jobs for adult people in place of those children who were removed from the work. So that was a great success story. And then Harvard and Oxford and many of the, you know, esteemed institutions in the world started talking about this story and this success. And now that is known as the first success story of this new innovation. People started calling this social innovation. Some called it social entrepreneurship. But we have the success story.
There is this misconception amongst a lot of us that child labor is something that affects the third world and developing countries more than maybe the first world, right? How does it, maybe you could tell us, how does child labor actually have a negative impact on the developed world also?
Well, I frankly, I will say that I hate these words like first world, second world, third world. The world is just one world. So we live in one earth. Is it not good enough? The earths are not two different earths. The world is one world. Americans walk on the same earth as we walk. They get the light from the same sun as we do. So no problem can be seen and solved in isolation, in fragmentation. We live in one world, so we have to look the world with that eye. Anyway, but in the southern hemisphere, we know the problem is much more serious. Though I have personally rescued, with the help of my local organizations and partners in America, in United States, the children who were local children, but of course the children who were Haitian and Mexican children who were working as child laborers in extremely hazardous conditions in tobacco and tobacco farms, actually. Even now, hundreds of thousands of children are working in tobacco production, in oranges and potato and tomatoes and so on in America. And so is in some parts of Europe, not in the Western Europe, but Eastern Europe definitely. So this is a global problem. But it affects the whole world, because when we talk of terrorism, many people thought for years that this is the localized problem of some countries. Now the whole politics of the world is driven by some phrases, and terrorism is one of them. Anti-terrorism, fight terrorism. We are also, you know, building alliances against terrorism and so on. So terrorism is a global problem. For years, people never thought about global warming and climate change as a global problem. They thought it's a localized problem. But now it's a global problem. So the poverty, unemployment, child labor, which perpetuates unemployment and poverty, as I said before, is a global problem. If a child is working or enslaved in any part of the world, means it is an harm, it's an evil for the whole humankind. That child who is working in appalling conditions in, say, Afghanistan or in Iraq or in South Sudan or in any other so-called developing country, that child could be manipulated, misused, misguided, indoctrinated by some terrorist or extremist forces, and that is happening. So a child who is in danger, the child who is deprived, is the easiest prey for those extremist forces, the violent extremist forces. They can use that child by brainwashing and using as a suicide bomber. So that could be a threat for any place or any person in the world. So I think we have to look at the problem in totality and solve it as one world.
I just wanted to check if anybody in the audience wants to lob a question here. Yeah. Is there a mic going around?
Yeah.
Yes.
We could start with that lady. We'll come to you later.
Sir, first of all, thank you very much for a very thought-provoking and inspiring speech. I would like to bring to your attention a recent interview on NDTV. It's Dr. Sunaina. Now, this little girl comes from a farming community, farmer's family, a poverty-stricken family, and wants to become a doctor, but no money for education. So, to cut the story short, what kind of reforms would you like to suggest in the Indian education sector in order to encourage such children to go to school?
Thank you. I also saw that story in the NDTV chief editor or the managing director himself was helping her, and I think they were able to mobilize resources for her, and hopefully she will become the doctor. But the first thing which is very, very important, that India has a constitutional right to basic education, primary education, and we have a law, right to education law. So every child is having that right to be educated up to the age of 14. But that is not enough. I started working, advocating and talking to the politicians from different parties across India that this law on right to education should be amended, and education should be made free and compulsory until the secondary classes. So it should not be just primary education, but every child should be ensured a good quality education up to the age of 18. So now it is up to the 14. So these 4 years are very critical, because during those 4 years, child marriages take place, children fall into slavery and trafficking, child labor and so on. So this age is very important, adolescence. And so every child should be given education up to the age of 18. So, and that will create a foundation to go to medicines or to engineering or to anything. If you are good in studies after completing your secondary education, then you can choose one of those disciplines. But the education should be free and compulsory. And that is also the part of global commitment. India is also committed to it. Unfortunately, this is not happening. The four things have to be achieved along with education. One is quality. Second one is equity. It should be equitable education. Then inclusive. So quality has to be ascertained, inclusion, and equity, so equitable education for all girls and boys, along with the lifelong learning opportunity. So that lifelong learning opportunity has to be ascertained under the law as well as in the schemes and budgetary allocations have to be made. I would also like to note here that India is proud of having 40% of its population, what we call the youth, young people below the age of 18. So they are our what we call the demographic dividend. But unfortunately, India spends less than 4% on education, health care, and protection combined on that segment of society. We spend 3.6 to 3.7% on education, health, and protection for those 40% young people of the country. And that has to change.
Thank you. Sir?
I saw your film, The Price is Free, and I urge everyone to watch it on YouTube. My question is, how do you get the courage in this circus scene that you mentioned when you were beaten up with your son? When you know you're going to get beaten or killed, still you are able to kind of do what you're doing.
Thank you. Thank you. How many of you watched this film, which is now nominated for Emmy Award? I'm not the director, I'm not the producer, neither I'm a hero in that film, nor I'm acting. But it's a documentary which has already won the best film award in the Sundance Film Festival of USA. And in several places, it is about a little bit my struggle and my life, but definitely the struggle of children and their successes. So that the price of free, and it is free also. You need not to pay any price, it is free on YouTube. So you can watch it on YouTube. Tomorrow is, so it's a weekend, so you have some time to watch it. Anyway, so thank you for reminding this. If you are driven by the deep compassion, then courage, conviction, kindness, gratitude come as offsets. They will come as the byproduct. The only thing which one has to ignite is compassion. Feel the suffering of others as it is your own suffering. And do every possible thing to eliminate that suffering. When a mosquito is biting you, you need not to make an additional effort. It happens. Even in the middle of the night when you are sleeping and mosquito bite, then your hand, your mind, your body, everything acts together without any additional effort. Effortlessly it helps. I'm trying to learn that whatever I have done in all my life, done effortlessly. It happens because I cannot live without that. If I was not doing it, what I was doing? If my children are dying, how can I sit quiet and sleep peacefully? No, it's not possible. My children anywhere in the world are my children. So that perhaps may give the courage. So everybody has that courage actually, because everybody has an ocean of compassion. I underline and repeat it here again.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Can I start?
Okay, we'll come back.
First of all, namaste to all of the dignitaries available on and off the dais. Sir, I don't have any question, but a request to you to share an experience where you find totally hopeless from all the sides. You wanted to do something, but you couldn't, and then finally you overcome. Why I am asking, I am requesting you to share an experience. Like, because if any common man like you work and to start such a big campaigning for the society, there are possibilities where we are totally hopeless and can't do anything. And finally, because of the compassion, we overcome and...
Like, yeah.
Thank you, sir.
As a human being, I was pained many a times. I cried many a times. And I don't shy in crying. However, we are taught that if you cry then, or you are emotional, then you are weak. It is not true. Crying needs much more courage than laughing. So it is not the weakness, it is the strength. I did it. But I tell you that when it comes of hope, I don't recall any incident, because I learned several things, but one small thing which everybody can apply. I learned to enjoy and celebrate small successes in my life, small successes. While I was struggling for the biggest success of my life, or the big successes in my life, I did not lose that opportunity of enjoying small successes. Like, I was talking to 10 people. None of them listened to me. They said, they laughed at me. When I first spoke in the World Bank in early 90s, or I think late 90s, about child labor, they laughed at me. They said, you are not an economist. Why did you come here? Why are you talking to us? Almost thrown me away. It happened many times with many intellectual people. But even if one person said, let us meet up again, I went back, and with my friends, I had pure vegetarian dosa, or a good pizza, vegetarian pizza, because I'm a vegetarian, and I enjoyed, even sitting alone in front of the World Bank, and I ate a good pizza, that somebody has said that, Kailash, let us meet up again and talk. And I started thinking that I'll meet him again. And then I met again, and again, and again. And there was a day when the president of World Bank, president of IMF, the director general of UNESCO, and Kailash Satyarthi launched a report that says that if you invest $1 on education, then the return would be $15. And the report, I was invited to launch the report by the presidents of all these agencies. So I always enjoyed fully my small successes. Then how can you become the hopeless?
Okay, I think we are running.
Today you met me. You can go and have a good pizza.
Okay, one last question. Yeah.
Shall I?
Yes. Thank you very much. I'm kind of speechless right now, but I might fumble, so please forgive me. But this is a really personal question connected to both of them. My name is Sabina, and I work in the field of innovation. Currently, I work more in corporate innovation, but I'm trying to work more for innovation for sustainable development. But unlike you, I mean, I have a lot of compassion, but not such a large, expanded sense of self. I struggle with a lot of courage. And there are these 3, 4, 5 dilemmas that keep coming up in my head when I think of stretching my compassion beyond a smaller scale community. Like, I do a lot of stuff in the community, but when it goes to beyond that, I just wanted to share them with you. One is, when I think of politics as a route, have policy change and, you know, applied compassion at a larger level, someone like me, can't even think of entering. I mean, I might be just shot down before, you know, I even think of. That's a nightmare that comes in my head. The second one is, I think of probably becoming someone like Bill Gates, probably be a very successful business person and then use my wealth for philanthropy. That seems possible, but I don't know if I have it in me to become an entrepreneur, but that's one. The third is sustainable businesses, kind of like, you know, the rug mark, but maybe being a consultant to more system. I wonder whether business is by far much better and more compassionate a route than even an NGO. So that's one thing I struggle with. The fourth is sometimes when I take up issues, even in my immediate circles, like justice at a corporate workplace, even if it's for women, I get shot down by the very people that I might be fighting for, because then when it goes beyond a certain level, everyone thinks about their job first, right? So then I wonder why I should take it up, if the very people I might be fighting for might not back me up. And the fourth is really just about self-preservation. Like, unlike you, I might not want to be beaten up, or I might not want to die very early. So it's a real dilemma.
Come here, Samina. Come here. Step up. Come. Sit here. Then keep on speaking. You have a very, very good soul, good heart. So keep on talking. I will listen.
Yes. So I really struggle with these four or five things every night when I sleep, because there are many things that I want to do, but I also want to live, and I'm also born in a very selfish era. So I'd be lying if I said that I, that I... I like all the finer things in life as well. I mean, I wouldn't want to be a Mahatma Gandhi style. I wouldn't want anyone to shoot me down. No,
you don't want to. Samina, the best thing is that you know who you are.
Yes.
Most people don't know. You also know where is the problem. Most people don't know. So you are much better than millions of people on this earth. The only thing is that sometimes we could not decide a clear purpose, sometimes, purpose of life. Sometimes we could not find the real clear path. So between path and purpose, we keep on struggling. The passion is there. So passion, path, and purpose should be combined. When you make others happy, when you do small bit so that you feel that you are making this world a better place than what you found when you learn understanding the world, would give you more strength. You can find some good friends who can help you. You keep on sharing your ideas as you are sharing here today in front of this big audience. But you share with some of the close friends, close ones in the family also, that you are not satisfied with the present situation in your life and the social life and the world life. You wanted to do something bigger. Make the list of all the things which you can do. And then choose one of them. Go ahead. That will become your purpose of life.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Yeah, okay, the last question for this evening.
Yes, sir. So I'm Professor Dr. Vivek from the Institute of Culture and Diplomacy in Germany. And my question is, today the current government is taking a lot of political decisions, right from the Kashmir decision to the Assam NRC decision. Usually these decisions lead to migration because it leads to people who are homeless, which leads to migration crisis, which further leads to economic disparities, economic crisis, which leads to in these particular states, which pushes down people into a lot of social injustice, which comes down, which automatically leads to. So what do you suggest for this, in fact, sir? It's a controversial question. I actually put it for you, but then what do you suggest about this?
Well, I am not a politician. And have no desire. So I really can't answer it. But I always aspire a world without boundaries. I dream a world. Because I strongly feel that children have never fought any war. Children have never divided humanity in the name of religions. Children have never been responsible for drawing the lines, what we call the borders in the world. They have not done it. Even the children have never thought of a stupid idea of passport. It is we, the adult people, very learned, very matured, very wise people who thought of a passport. 1,000 or 2,000 years ago, who can think of passport? Is it the evolution of human civilization when we started thinking of visa, putting the visa? I am invited by the government and meeting the president, Sumedhaji and I, next week in Ireland, huh? And Premaji went for my visa. Sumedhaji is on my visa, and today she said that, "Oh, sir, you are granted visa." So that's why this thing came to my mind, that children have not done it. So let us learn from our children. We have taught so many things to our children, so many things. And we have divided this world in pieces. We have made so many fragmentation and compartmentalization and hatred and wars and whatnot. As wise people, matured people, diplomats, leaders, champions for humanity, faith leaders, gurus, for God's sake, don't teach these things to our children. If we have to make this world a better place, let us learn from our children. We should learn from our children. Since it was the last question, I guess, yes. I can just say one thing in a few seconds, that some of you might have watched my Nobel acceptance speech. So you could recall a moment when I lost my speaking notes. And these Nobel acceptance speeches are considered immense wealth for ages, because people do researches and all kind of things. Even on one sentence, the people do their PhDs. What Nelson Mandela has said, or Martin Luther King, or whatever, Dalai Lama. So they insist that we have to prepare a written speech. So I was keeping a written note, but I lost the papers on the dais. Everybody was nervous. The whole world was watching. As they say that this is the second largest watched episode after what you know. The first one is cricket. No cricket. This is the football FIFA World Cup final. And the Nobel acceptance speech is peace speech, the second. Not that day, but people keep on watching. So everybody was nervous. So, and a story came to my mind that there was a heavy fire broken out in jungle. All animals, birds, including king lion, were leaving the jungle, rushing fast out. And lions noticed that there was a tiny hummingbird flying straight towards the flames. And he shouted, "What are you doing? Committing suicide?" Bird answered, "No, sir. I was born and grew up here in this jungle. I lived here all my life. I cannot leave. I am going to extinguish this fire." Then he was surprised more and shouted, "How come?" This bird answered, "Look at my beak. I am carrying a drop of water. I am doing my bit. Rest is the legend, rest is the history." That story I read in my childhood suddenly came to my mind on that dais, and I said, "This is my life, this is me." And not just Kailash Satyarthi, there is a tiny hummingbird inside each one of you, my dear young friends, inside you, inside you, inside you. How long you will keep on repressing it? How long you will keep it suppressing it? Today, Samina, your hummingbird was speaking. You cannot suppress it any further, I know. All of you, I am not here just to give a speech. I am not If I sit at home, even then I will remain the Nobel laureate. Nobody can, because I am not going to contest election so that I should give beautiful speeches everywhere. What would I gain out of it? I am here to awaken the tiny hummingbird which is inside each one of you. Awaken it. Don't suppress any further. This is my message tonight. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Satyarthi. It's been a very stimulating evening, and you've given us a lot to think about, and more importantly, to feel about also. Thank you.